Good morning and welcome to Morning Java, brought to you as always by Get Go Cafe and Market. Well, right now, Matt, they are serving the pilgrim sandwich. They got that stuffing bread. They got the roast turkey, the white cheddar cheese and gravy with some good cranberry sauce. I've had this sandwich, man. I'm telling you, everybody should.
I haven't tried it yet. Sounds like Thanksgiving dinner in your hands there. I'm kind of eager to try it.
Get you one today. But Pitt couldn't get their W this past weekend. They went up against Notre Dame, top 10 team, now the top five. Were they with top five before? Where are they?
They were fifth coming into it.
Now they're top four because of all the top 10 losses. But can you describe what you saw? You were there.
Oh, I mean, it's a heartbreaker for the Panthers because
they had them.
They led for more than 40 minutes of the game.
Yep.
You know, Pitt gets a stop on the first drive, then puts together a 9-minute
20-some-second
drive.
The perfect start to the game.
I mean, it's exactly how you want to do when you're pulling an upset. Control the ball. Pitt goes into halftime with a 7-6 lead, return the opening kickoff of the second half, and just couldn't get anything going on offense. They couldn't sustain a drive, and when they did, Alex Kessman, who's been so reliable kicking field goals, misses two in the game. And, you know, in the end, Notre Dame just too much on offense. They finally hit really the only deep ball they hit all day in the passing game for the go-ahead touchdown. Pitt still gets two more possessions. Can't get it. It was a heartbreaker. I got to say, that was a great Pitt crowd there. It was a full section.
I heard Let's Go Pitt chants.
It was really quiet. There were some stunned Irish fans for a lot of that game. And you could hear, you know, great traveling support for Pitt. And it's just, you know, tough to see it end like that. You know, a disappointing loss. They all count the same. But, you know, when you're a team that's fighting for bowl eligibility, I mean, that would have been a huge
like
one
that.
To have.
Yeah, that would have put them on the map for everyone. It would have given Narduzzi another thing to show, hey, I'm doing something here. But coming up short, you know, and then people said after the game, there's no moral victories about this.
Mm-hmm.
I think one thing I am impressed about the defense. It's performing better, but Kenny Pickett's still not showing enough for me.
Yeah.
So, Matt, Pitt now, tough loss. They get a bye week to lick their wounds, but they get Duke in 2 weeks at Heinz Field.
Yeah, and that's going to be now a huge game for Pitt. It was already big when you consider they're still 2-1 in ACC play.
Yeah.
And now with Miami getting upset by Virginia, there's only one undefeated team, Virginia Tech, who Pitt still sees left in their division. So it's wide open still in the Coastal. But that Duke game, they only have two home games left out of their last five. And so it's one they really need to get if they want to have any thoughts of getting bowl eligible.
And this is one of those games that everyone's talking about how this is one of the games they have to win. Narduzzi has to be able to show that his team can beat the opponents that they're supposed to beat so that they can get a shot to be bowl eligible. If they did that, it would make those losses to the big opponents like Notre Dame a little bit more acceptable. Mm-hmm. But when you're already losing to teams like North Carolina when they're missing half their team because of whatever reason, you can't afford to then and also lose your big gains because now you're putting yourself in the hole.
Yeah, and you know, I'm still looking at the home away split being a big issue here. Now, granted, two of Pitt's home or away games were at Central Florida at Notre Dame,
two of the toughest teams in the nation.
Two really tough teams, but at the same time, they're 0-3 on the road. So with only two home games left, Duke and then Virginia Tech in November, you know, Pitt's got to continue to hold their own and you know find a way to get a road win at Virginia, Wake Forest, they've still got coming up. They haven't shown that they can do it outside of Heinz Field. They've put out some good performances. The defense showed against Georgia Tech. The offense showed up against Syracuse. But I think that really is the biggest thing. They haven't had a game where all three phases have clicked at once.
And here's my thing. At the end of the day, they're supposed to play Miami again. I think Miami's going to be out for blood after Pitt ruined their season last year. Now you're going down to South Florida. It's going to be a rough time against them. I don't see them beating too many of these guys because when they see them.
And if you're right, that just means that much more pressure on these next few before that season finale.
Exactly.
Down to Thanksgiving weekend in Miami. You know, you're a Pittsburgh guy, been around a while, so you probably remember back in one of the old mayor elections, there were those commercials, where's Luke? Asking where the mayor was.
Yes, indeed.
Now the question in Pittsburgh is, where's Le'Veon? That seems to be the watch that everybody's on now.
Seriously.
Where is Le'Veon? Where is he?
That's a good question. I mean, so here's my thing. The story being Le'Veon Bell not showing up to camp. Everyone knows that. You're going into Tuesday now, and we're all saying, is he going to show up? Mm-hmm. The thing is about Jeremy Fowler's report, which Adam Schefter, you know, reminded everyone on social media saying, Fowler specifically said he would arrive sometime during this week. Mm-hmm. Did not say Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, whenever. So there's still a chance that he could still arrive this week. Mm-hmm. For me, I think the big thing is what Dale's been talking to guys in the locker room about. It's like, they don't care. It's mm-hmm. the Steelers I'm talking about. They're in a situation where they're in a bye week. They're coming off of two big wins. They're going into two divisional games coming up. Their mentality is they have to play with the winners, they have to win with the players that are available. And I think that's the storyline right now. Until Le'Veon Bell shows up, then they'll deal with whatever that is.
Yeah, and at 3-2-1, momentum is on their side, yes. too. And they have the luxury with this bye week of, you know, if he shows, they can install some things in the offense, mm-hmm. get him up to speed. If he doesn't, well, they got plenty of time to maybe do some things that in training camp they were still thinking, oh, well, we have to consider yeah. Le'Veon's going to be back week one. He wasn't.
Yeah.
You know, now they have that extra week that maybe a few days to install some new wrinkles, maybe things they weren't expecting to have James Conner do. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, he's going to be the guy if Le'Veon doesn't.
And last year also, I think a big thing is that you saw after the bye week, that's when Ben Roethlisberger's mechanics came back as a mm-hmm. quarterback, and he was able to hit those deep balls. And that's still not really been a consistent part of this offense this year. And I think that's another reason why it's remarkable that they're getting the yards that they have been mm-hmm. because they're attacking horizontally more. I think it's a major story if Ben Roethlisberger takes this time, comes back from this week, whether or not Le'Veon Bell is here and he's chucking the ball downfield.
All right, Chris, you know, coming off a Bengals win, it seems like you can't have a Steelers-Bengals game without the name Vontaze Burfict being in the news. And once again, especially in social media areas, you know, you see, didn't see much of it during the game, but you see that arm come out, try to take the headshot of Antonio mm-hmm. Brown, and suddenly the world is up in arms again.
I mean, the shot definitely was along the lines. I mean, when I saw it live, I'm looking at that play. I didn't even see the elbow. I just saw how his head was just leaning forward. Yeah. And that's the exact shot the NFL has been saying, we're trying to legislate out the game. Mm-hmm. There wasn't a flag thrown. There wasn't a nothing. And I was like, whoa, that's a, and I was like, maybe he didn't make contact with his head. He didn't. He used his elbow. But I mean, still, that's the exact shot he took out Antonio Brown with years ago in the playoffs. I mean, it just looked exactly the same. Yeah. The only difference is his helmet collided with his teammate and not Antonio Brown in this situation. You know, thank goodness for Antonio. Sean Williams got taken out the game with a concussion because Vontaze Burfict was that reckless. But the big story, he's not getting suspended. I mean, it continues to be, you know, and David DeCastro made a great point to the media. He said, you know, all this talk about wanting to protect your superstar quarterbacks, what's going on with protecting your superstar wide receivers? Right. And Antonio Brown is that. Vontaze Burfict has been doing this for years, and you continue to just tell him, it's okay.
Yeah, and that's, you know, you look a week ago, T.J. Watt gets fined for, you know, maybe
barely
invading the personal space of Matt Ryan, we'll call it,
because
it was hardly a hit. But, you know, the quarterback gets that sort of protection, then all of a sudden, I mean, receivers are a protected position,
they're
too. I mean,
there
are flags all over the place now for hitting a defenseless receiver. We've seen a little less of those as DBs have gotten used to the calls. But, you know, these are the sorts of things that are supposed to be disappearing from the game. And, you know, it's one thing maybe the NHL has gotten right in recent years, the NFL isn't, the whole repeat offender status thing. Yeah. I mean, if you've got a guy who is, you know, game in and game out, and it's not just against the Steelers. Burfict's had run-ins with other
teams. Cam Newton's called him out. A lot of players have said that this guy needs to stop.
Until there's some discipline that's actually going to hurt him or the team, either him in the wallet or the team by not having their guy for, talking eight games sort of thing. Why is he going to get rid of him for a season?
You have to send the message, this is not going to happen. Eight games, they've suspended him before. They need to suspend him for a full season, no appeal. You got to sit a year out because you are endangering people and not in the spirit of the game. That needs to be the message. It hasn't been. He's getting away with it. And another fine, he's going to do this again.
And you know what? The other thing to think about, it's, you know, talking about Ryan Shazier going back to Cincinnati, the emotion about that. Mm-hmm. You know, I just, you know, you never want to wish harm upon another person, but Burfict's putting himself in a situation where he might hurt himself as much as he could hurt another person.
His head being down, I mean, that's
just out of line, and it's amazing the NFL hasn't stepped in yet.
Yeah.